two, four, six, eight. Who does NASCAR appreciate? Last year's even-numbered points finishers get their turn to test their Nextel Cup cars at Daytona. They include the semi-retired Awesome Bill, last year's winningest driver, Flying Ryan, and Super G with a new do. In fact, the entire Hendrick stable is in town. Engineers and mechanics are dialing up to get their cars dialed in. Body fabricators are earning their money, too. No matter how you slice it, it's time to go fast again. Week two of Nextel Cup testing begins now on Speed News Countdown to Daytona. Everyone, I'm John Roberts, and this is Speed News Preseason Thunder Countdown to Daytona. As racing's equivalent to spring training rolls on, more heavy hitters took the track at the World Center of Racing. The even-numbered points finishers from last year's Cup Championship started their three-day test session today, and just by luck, all four Hendrick Motorsports teams and both of Roger Penske's top squads are in the same group. Let's take a look at the afternoon testing session and a former Daytona 500 pole sitter himself. One of those Hendrick cars topped the speed chart. Jimmy Johnson was fastest. And as you can imagine, the DEI entry, the number one John Andretti car, was right behind Jimmy Johnson on the chart as well. And even though his schedule may be limited, his speed was not. Bill Elliott was third fastest in his number 91 Ray Evernham powered Dodge, and we all know about the Wood brothers and how they do on this track. Ricky Rudd fast all day long in the afternoon session as well. Another car to keep an eye on that's shown very well in this test session is the number 49 BAM Dodge driven by Ken Schrader as they continue to work out their sponsorship issues. A little bit of speed at Daytona testing always helps out. Let's take a look at some speeds. Here's the chart from the afternoon testing. Bill Elliott was the guy who made the biggest move up the chart. You see Rudd's Ford in fourth, but the next fastest Ford was Elliott Sadler down in the 19th spot. Ryan Newman picked up two, and rookie Brian Vickers found some speed as well. Back to the morning test session, which was the first for this group, and it should come as no surprise that right out of the truck, the DEI car was the fastest in the clean air. John Andretti in the one car topped the speed charts. Ken Schrader was second fastest in the 49. And again, that's so great to see, considering it was questioned as to whether that team was even going to run this year. Now, the Wood brothers have a very long history of running well at Daytona, and no change this season. Ricky Rudd in the 21 had the third fastest lap, turning a 48.2. Now, second-year driver Casey Mears is back behind the wheel of Chip Ganassi's 41 target car, and Ernie Elliott powered Dodge had a fast lap of 48.2 as well, 186.4 miles per hour, and there's your former pole sitter at Daytona himself, Jimmy Johnson, in the 48 in the morning was fifth fastest, just a hair faster than the boss, Jeff Gordon, who was sixth fastest in the morning session. Now, another tip of the hat has to go out to Schrader and that BAM Dodge. Although that team has run well on the big tracks before, you will remember he nearly won the Budweiser shootout last year. Chevy Dodge, Ford Dodge Chevy shows us that the manufacturers are well represented. Scott Riggs will be running for Rookie of the Year honors in the 10 car, and he is off to a good start. Well, to many Nextel Cup drivers, the first day of testing with a lone car on a super speedway is a little like watching grass grow. Let's join Speed's Bob Dillner. And Bob, for the crews, this test session has to be what shows them if their preseason work is really paying off.
Well, that's true, John, but it's kind of like watching paint dry. Maybe not grass grow, but certainly paint dry. But a lot of teams today, during day number one of this test, baselining their cars. And a lot of them are baselining off of what their teammates learned last week. And that can be a big advantage, especially for teams like the RCR boys.
We're lacking just a little bit, but we're not bad by any means. So we just got to go home and see what Robbie and Johnny come out of the test with, and that's the good thing about having a test split up with the multiple teams is we got a good baseline for them, and they can try all the stuff that we need to try. So hopefully after their test we'll be just a little bit better, but we're not bad.
And now this week the testing torches pass to Harvick's RCR teammates Johnny Sauter and Robbie Gordon. Many multi-car teams are enjoying the split session, but all four Hendrick teams are here this week. In fact, they own Garage C at Daytona.
We were pretty fortunate. We got in pretty early this morning, and We came over here and we kind of quarantined off this this whole garage building here, and we kind of got some room to spread out, so it was nice. It's a good thing. The way the Hendrick teams are working together right now, it's amazing. So whenever we get an opportunity to be like this and share information and work with one another, it's only going to help us. So we're pretty happy about it.
We brought Mark's other car, his slower car of the bunch, and it turns out to be our faster car. Actually, we picked up our other car to the same speed as it. So it's helpful to baseline something last week, and then this week we kind of have an idea where we're at as a group.
At RCR, we share a lot, or everything. So what Kevin came down to learn with last week is what we started this week with, and that's kind of been about the best that we've gone so far. You know, I think we're gonna come back here and we'll pick up a bunch when we do for qualifying for the race.
Elliott Sadler is working with what Dale Jarrett baselined for him last week, but he's the only guy in both sessions to have the new escape hatch on his car.
Hey, I'm a pretty big boy, so I gotta have the escape hatch. It's something that after I saw it on Michael Waltrip's car at Talladega last year, I was like, look, guys, we got to have this. You know, some of these guys have hit driver's side and catch on fire. I know I cannot get through the right-hand side window. I'm too big of a boy with the Hans and helmet and everything on. So my guys have taken the extra time and built me some escape hatches, and I thank them for it. So I'm going to test it here a few times here during the test, getting in and out of it while I'm not panicking, because I know it'll be a lot different when you panic. So I really got to thank my guys at Shot for working with me on it and having it down here for me.
Sadler's looking for a fresh start at Daytona, but the guy who has the fresh new look was the talk of the garage.
You know, it was off season and I was bored, I guess. I don't know, I don't have a good story for it, really. I just saw it somewhere on somebody and I said, I wonder what that'd look like that. So, you know, during the off season, you can do those kind of things. The only thing is that I kind of liked it, so I trimmed it down one more time and it hasn't grown back yet, but I'm gonna grow back for the season, and I don't know. I didn't know it'd draw any attention. I just doing it for fun.
Well, I think Jeff Gordon's new haircut looks very aerodynamic, but I don't know if the chicks are gonna dig it. Anyway, speeds here at Daytona today match or surpass that of last week's speeds already, and that's because of one big reason. Absolutely beautiful weather here in Daytona today. Temperatures 70 degrees and absolutely no wind, and of course, those multi-car teams learned a lot last week, and they are already applying it to this week, John.
Bob, we read yesterday that the 09 car was going to be piloted by Johnny Benson. I know a lot of his fans were really glad to read that he was going to be back behind the wheel of a car, but he was not the guy that was testing that car today, was he?
No, one of the old guys, Joe Ruttman, that's what he calls himself, the old guy, was behind the wheel of that 09 car here today. Johnny Benson will wheel that car in the Daytona 500 and maybe some other races this year. He might also wheel the James Finch-owned Busch car as well. We learned today David Stremme will not be in that number one car this year for James Finch. David will have an announcement in the next couple of weeks to let us know what he's doing for this season.
Hey, Bob, we know if anybody preaches teamwork in Nextel Cup Racing, it's got to be that Hendrick bunch. What was it like to see all those teams down there with all their manpower working together and really just because it comes down to the luck of the draw that they're all down there at the same time?
Well, it was, I don't know if it's luck of the draw, because I think they would have liked to have had a car here last week to kind of baseline off of. But Garage C was filled with Hendrick employees today. Jeff Gordon, Jimmy Johnson, Terry Labonte, and rookie Brian Vickers all there. And the massive amount of engineers was absolutely incredible. In fact, I talked to Larry McReynolds a little while ago, and he told me, you know, the engineers they have here, the amount of them, heck, I didn't even bring that many guys to test with me years ago here at Daytona.
All right, Bob Dillner, thanks a lot. We'll have more from Bob later on in this half hour. NASCAR Nextel Cup drivers and teams will continue the search for speed at Daytona for two more days, and we have you covered here on Speed. Join us for more Preseason Thunder Wednesday and Thursday live at 6 Eastern. Larry McReynolds has seen more than his share of testing over the years. He'll be along next to talk about what has been going on so far at Daytona. And later, a conversation with 2003 Speed Channel Driver of the Year, Ryan Newman. Among the even-numbered points finishers from last season are some of the heavy favorites to run up front this season. And among all of them is Fox and Speed Channel analyst Larry McReynolds. And Larry Mack, Being that the speed charts just tell part of the story, you really can't compare this test session to last week's session, can you?
No, I was not here for that final test session for the odd number cars last week. Jeff Hammond was here, and he told me that the weather was really not very favorable any of the 3 days for a good qualifying type run. It was cold, the wind was blowing, the wind was unpredictable, but I'm going to tell you, being here today, it was almost perfect conditions for a good fast lap. So no, I don't think we can compare at least the first day of this test to the 3 days from last week.
Now, Larry, all you have to do is take a look around that garage, and you can see how important engineers have become to Nextel Cup Racing. Does it surprise you to see so many laptops out there?
I mean, even some of the teams that you wouldn't expect to maybe have engineers and laptops, like the Arnold Motorsports team or like the James Finch team, you know, those guys, they had two or three engineers. And you heard Bob Dillner talking about the Hendrick Motorsports group. They have more engineers and laptops than I think 10 years ago I brought total people just to do the two-car test with.
Well, Larry, what about the softer tire that we've been hearing so much about? Are teams seeing a change in that so far this early in testing?
Well, it starts here at Daytona. Of course, I think the biggest effect is going to be starting at Rockingham, Las Vegas, and on from there. You know, the test that Goodyear did here with Michael Waltrip and some of the other teams back in August or September of last year, the drivers didn't really feel a difference. But the biggest curveball that's been thrown at these teams is this tire flexes a lot more. It moves around because not only is it a softer compound, it's a softer sidewall. So they've really been having to work on the left rear quarter panel because as the car goes in the corner and travels, it's been rubbing that corner panel. In fact, I watched Elliott Sadler's group, the 38 team, they had to almost completely cut their left rear quarter panel off and replace it before they could even get a run in this morning.
Hey, Larry, when you have so much else to worry about at a test session, can teams really hold back and not show their hands this early in testing?
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. And there's a few things you can do, especially at a restrictor plate racetrack where you're running wide open to hold a little bit back. You know, you maybe can be a little up on your rear spoiler, maybe a little bigger with the rear spoiler. And I know when I was with Richard Childress Racing, you heard Kevin Harvick say it, even though he was down on the speed charts last week, they're not too bad. Trust me, even though all three of the Childress teams are maybe down on the speed charts, when qualifying happens in about a month, I guarantee you they'll be near the top of the speed charts. You want to come here, you want to do everything you can to learn all you can, ABC and stuff, but you maybe don't want to show exactly how fast you can run because if you do, that'll make the other teams work harder.
Hey, Larry, with the rule changes coming down, it seems like there's so many of them, but when it comes right down to the cars and the manufacturers, for Daytona, there's really not that many, are there?
No, there really isn't. You know, when you look at the speed charts, you talked about it earlier, John. You know, there's a lot of the manufacturers are all represented there in the top 10. And this is the same rules that we had at the Talladega Fall race. The same restrictor plate, the same spoiler size. Now, it's a little different from February, from the Daytona 500 last year. Little bigger restrictor plate, little bigger rear spoiler, more drag. The speeds are going to be a little quicker because that bigger restrictor plate's about 20 to 25 more horsepower than a year ago.
Well, Larry Mack, thanks so much for joining us today. We look forward to more of your coverage tonight, tomorrow, and Thursday. Ignition systems help bring race cars to life. Having a backup can mean the difference between winning and losing. Coming up, we'll tell you what NASCAR is doing to make things equal in the garage. And later, the inspiring story behind Brendan Gaughan's special helmet. Budweiser Shootout is the first competitive NASCAR racing of the season at Daytona. The All-Star Race is made up of previous shootout winners, all the Bud Pole winners from 2003, and that can make for some surprises. Mike Skinner and Boris Said both won poles last season, but even though they don't have regular cup rides this year, they'll be in the show.
So I called Jay and said, hey, I sure would like to run the Bud Shootout, and it doesn't really conflict with anything. And he said he could probably help me out to do that. They just don't have the manpower and the cars to run the race. They're going to do their best to put something together for me, and he hasn't totally guaranteed me, but I think he's going to try real hard.
You know, Ryan's given me a great car, and with the U.S. Army on board, I mean, it's an exciting thing for me. I have realistic goals. I don't think I'm going to go there and, you know, show those guys anything or even win, but if I can go there and, you know, just look like I belong out there and stay in the draft and make some passes, get past, you know, and just finish the race, you know, hopefully I can accomplish that.
Other drivers without regular cup rides qualified for the Bud Shootout include Dave Blaney and Steve Park. Blaney is expected to race a Bill Davis Dodge, while Park is also looking to run an Intrepid now that he has a full-time truck ride in a Dodge. We don't have to be a Las Vegas odds maker to pick Ryan Newman as a favorite to win the first official Nextel Cup Championship. But after 8 wins and 11 poles in 2003, all eyes are on the 12 car, and Speed's Bob Dillner found out that's just the way Ryan likes it.
You know, John, when you come down to testing, it's pretty busy in the garage area, but it's pretty relaxing as well. Everybody has a fresh start. One guy that is certainly refreshed is the recently married Ryan Newman. So you ready to get this season kick-started?
What is pretty busy?
Did I say pretty?
Pretty busy.
I guess I've been living in the South too long.
No, we're just down running some laps and having some fun. Actually, first time I've been in a car since Homestead. So it's been a while. First time for me in a long time. It's been that long since I've been in a race car, so it feels good to get back in one. And the Autel Dodge is running pretty strong, and tough to see how things go. We're just logging some laps. So last year we came down here, we were like anywhere between first and fifth throughout the whole test session. Came back and qualified, I think, 36th or 41st or something. So taking a little different approach.
Now this year, Goodyear brings a little softer rubber combination down here, and a lot of guys said they could feel it a little bit. How about you?
I have no same difference. Just running, you know, the two-lap runs there, you don't really notice a whole lot. We'll notice that when we get in a big draft and the tires start to wear off and everything, it's pretty hot.
I'm sure in a couple of days you're going to be doing a little drafting work as well. Last year, of course, went upside down here at Daytona. I know you want to change that luck here at Daytona this time around.
Yeah, we needed some groove tires last year. We definitely want to change the luck. But, you know, a lot of it's just being in the right place at the right time. And, you know, obviously if we'd have been up front in that situation, we wouldn't have come across that the wall. So, you know, it's just about putting yourself in the right position, and hopefully we can do that.
Now, last year, a bunch of wins and pretty good point standing, but I know you want to boost that up a little bit this year. What do you have to do this year to kind of change that a little bit?
Well, the DNFs killed us last year, that was for sure. You know, our running.
Oh, wait a second. Now you're having trouble.
I didn't say perky. I said R, like, you know, a dog or something. No, I just, our performances were great, with the exception of the DNFs. We were always running up front. We just didn't always finish up front, and that's what we need to fix for next year or this year.
And now we have a playoff situation in NASCAR this year. What do you think about that with the change in the point structure?
It's the same for everybody. I guess that's about all you can say.
Congratulations on the wedding. I mean, did that all go well?
Oh, yeah, went good.
He's a newly married man, and he's trying to become the first Nextel Cup champion.
Pertty.
We got it, John?
Well, Newman was very impressive in 2002, actually taking Rookie of the Year honors and winning a points race as well as the Winston All-Star event. But boy, did that change in his sophomore season. More poles and wins than anyone else, but a couple of really bad races, including that wild flip in the Daytona 500, put him 6 in points, same as the previous year. One of the many changes in the Cup Series this year is one you can actually see on the race car. The ignition boxes are now in plain view on the dashboards. Fox and Speed Channel analyst Larry McReynolds tells us there are a couple of reasons for this change.
The electrical system of a Nextel Cup Series car, it can be pretty complicated, but it's pretty important to the performance of how this car performs on the racetrack. Now, in 2003, NASCAR gave teams an option of where the ignition system, the ignition panel, was mounted in the car. It pretty much could be anywhere inside the race car. But in 2004, not only in the Nextel Cup Series, but the Busch Series as well as the Craftsman Truck Series, NASCAR has made the teams mount all of the components that's part of the ignition system in plain view. It has to be right here on the top side, on the right-hand side of the dash. And this is where everything can be seen. You have the ignition boxes, you have the coils, you have the coil selector, and you also have the rev limiters. Now, one of the big reasons they've done this is the fact that over the last few years, a lot of talk has been about teams using traction control. That's something that's been hidden the ignition system. The thing about having it here, the inspectors of NASCAR as well as competitors can see what all is about your ignition system. Traction control could be very important to the performance of a race team, especially at a short track like Martinsville or possibly a road course where hooking those rear tires up to the racetrack are so important. Another reason they put it way over here on the right-hand side of the dash, it's far away from the driver. He can't do anything during the race
that can change anything about this ignition system. Now, John Darby, technical director of NASCAR, also told me that another reason they put it here in plain view on the right side is that during a race, a NASCAR official can even peek in here and quickly see if anything has been added or anything has been taken away. Now, from a team or crew chief standpoint, what I like about it being mounted here, it's easy to get to. It's easy to spot a problem if you're having a problem with the ignition system at any time during the racetrack. So put it right here where everybody can see it. It's just another way that NASCAR is trying to take a variable away from the competition and keep that rumor of teams using traction control out of the equation.
Larry, thanks. There are still tickets left for All Speed Week's events at the World Center of Racing. Just log on to Daytona500.com or call 1-800-PIT-SHOP. Don't get left outside of the track for NASCAR's biggest race of the year. When Brendan Gaughan was supposed to be announced as the driver for the Penske Jasper 77 car, he wasn't immediately available. He spent the New Year's holiday with other NASCAR personalities in Iraq visiting U.S. troops, and as part of his continuing support to the men and women overseas, he's wearing a specially designed helmet signed by an Army unit stationed in Baghdad.
We had the opportunity, the ESGR, Speedway Children's, same thing that we got to do last year. When we went to tame places last year, we went right into the meet this year, man. Went a couple places that no civilians had been. You ain't got enough tape in that camera, I'm telling you, to talk about this.
We're flying the Black Hawk helicopters about 50 feet off the ground at 160 mile an hour right over Baghdad City, and got to hold Saddam's machine gun, one of his guns that they'd confiscated. And
Roush was firing away, too. Jack looked pretty cool then, but watch out for Rambo. Tony Liberati, he got on that sniper rifle a little too comfortable.
You know, I was really proud of everybody that went. You know, I've raced against Jack for many years, and we've been fierce competitors, but over there, man, I got a lot of respect for him and every one of the people that went over it.
Well, NASCAR Championship team owner Jack Roush also made that trip. 2 years after surviving a plane crash, today Roush was named the first winner of the SKF X-Tracker Award for achievement in the automotive industry. SKF designs, tests, and builds automotive parts worldwide. Well, thanks for coming along for the ride for this edition of Speed News Countdown to Daytona. We'll be back tomorrow with all the latest from Nextel Cup testing at the World Center of Racing. I'm John Roberts. Have a great night.
For motorsports coverage 24/7, log on to speedtv.com.